Actually, the environments around the pod race, the Jags crash. it was a really good blend of mixing. Certainly when we went into the film, when the film was being discussed that it's going to be made, we were all panicking, thinking, great, right, we're actually going to work on it, because, you know, drones are one of the only CGI. And then we were busier. We had 87 people in the model shop working, which is unheard of. We've never had that many people in the model shop. So at most, maybe 30 or 40 people. So we doubled just to work on that. Like I said, I worked on it for 18 months, so, and that's the longest film I've worked on, at any film.
Okay, I have a question for you. How did you feel dealing with, say, animated characters and acting against them? And also, obviously, the movie took a long time to make, but how long did you actually spend on the project?
This is a question for me.
Yeah.
I was on it about 2 months. It's a good question. It was a kind of steep learning curve, because about 95% of the movie involved blue screen acting, and I take it you're all familiar with this term, blue screen, and what's involved. Is it not? Don will explain it to you. You act against a screen, and then you can program the computer to remove everything except that color, or remove all that color, and stuff, and then you can paint in the background or some kind of activity behind you. So when you are working with that much blue screen, it means that you don't always know what you're reacting to. The guys at ILM, John Noel, who's the visual effects supervisor, was always very happy to give us an idea. He could always look at the picture on his laptop to see what the scene was meant to look like. And sometimes it was not simply useful, but necessary. For example, in the Senate scene, it kind of determines the extent of your reaction. If the Senate is this size, it's one thing. If it's the size it was on the roof, it's another thing. In other words, if you're addressing people all in there and down there, it will determine the how far you pitch or just where you look. And to my surprise, they didn't really make a point of showing us the image until a bit later on. You know, for example, when we were in the forest of the holy place where the Gungans had retreated to. There wasn't a big fat bullfrog called Boss Master. There was just a big fat actor in a red sweatshirt called Brian Blessed. Okay, he's a personal friend. He's big and fat. And he was standing on top of the hill doing all this. That's what we were reacting to. And of course, the first take, Jake Lloyd cracks up and says, "You were going to crash up." That's what he was doing. But they did at that point show us what the scene was meant to look like, but there was a huge discrepancy between what the scene was meant to look like and what Brian Blessed was actually doing. So sometimes it was difficult, it was challenging. I have to say, having seen the first time I saw the movie, I thought, a few things I'd do differently if I could go back. Just react a bit more, because we didn't always know quite, well, I didn't anyway, quite what was happening when, because they would shoot the scene about the same scene with different cameras, but also with and without people representing CGI figures. They had the very tall actors in white overalls with droid masks. And we'd play the scene with them in and then with them out. You know, for example, when the Jedi jumped down from the balcony and rescued the Queen's party, we did that scene a couple times where these people falling down in the place of the droids, and then we did them with the Jedi striking an air. They were just there as reference. But that was a case in point, really, where I think we could and should have reacted a little bit more dramatically. But should we say that on the planet Naboo, we are impacted. We forgot. But, they
fixed that.
Like, yeah. They can fix anything with CGI. Except the bad performance. I hope that answers the question.
First, I have to say, like, you guys are all legends, but Timothy Zahn, I just wanted to say also your Thrawn trilogy is fantastic. It's best. It's the first. It's what got me into reading all the Star Wars books in the first place. I could actually hear Star Wars music while I was reading it. But I just wanted to ask both the writers, what sort of things do you have to go through to keep all the consistency, like to make sure that you don't cross over and change something that someone else has written, what sort of stuff?
Yeah,
let me just make sure I heard the question. There's a lot of reverb over here. Who do we have to run, jump through, make sure and keep continuity and all of that with the writing? We do the best we can. We hope that the editors and Lucasfilm catch the stuff we didn't. Part of the problem is that certainly while the Phantom line was being done, there would be two or three or more books being written that we couldn't possibly have read because they weren't done yet. And we had, sometimes we would get outlines for those books in advance. But a writer does not always stay with the outline, so those are only as a partially helpful guide. It was a matter of trying to keep track with our editors, who hopefully did know everything that was still in the pipeline. And then finally, with the Lucasfilm people, who of course were reading everything as well. The discrepancies did show up here and there. There was no way to avoid them all. We just did the best we could to try not to step on everybody else's toes.
Yeah, a lot of what I have to do in the X-Wing books and in the X-Wing comics was spackle and fill over holes. So we'd notice an error, and I'd figure out a way to correct it, and then that would go through. And it was a lot of fun. For me, because I was trained as a historian, doing the research, collecting the information, you know, cataloging in my brain was relatively easy. And when I send in manuscripts, both the comic scripts and toward the novels, I would have them footnoted. So the continuity people would be able to see what the sources were that I'd used. Or there'd be footnotes saying, look, I made this up. This is what I want it to be able to do. You know, if you aren't going to approve this, at least give me this little bit here. Otherwise, I have to change the story. Working on iJedi, when I was working on iJedi and Tim was doing Vision of the Future, we were phoning back and forth all the time because we were shooting characters back and forth and doing things. And it was a lot of fun. And keeping continuity in that context was pretty easy.
Yeah, the continuity was... A lot of the contacts between the authors tended to break down along social lines, people who knew each other before the Star Wars books. So you have Kevin Anderson and Barbara Hambley did a lot of work, coordination back and forth, because they knew each other before that. Mike and I had known each other, so we tended to coordinate our stuff back and forth. So there was not a mass meeting of all writers twice a year or anything formal like that. We would simply talk to the people we tended to know best, and other than that, go through our editors and the Lucasfilm people to try to keep coordinated. That's why the only characters really who show up in my books, aside from my characters, are Mike's, because I felt comfortable with talking to him about borrowing characters and having him vet the chapters and see if I got them right, and vice versa in a lot of cases.
Have they come up with a writer's guide to try and keep things in context?
There are bookcases. Basically, all of the novels, all the game product, all the comic books, all the various source books are canon. So, I mean, I've got, you know, a bookcase full of this stuff just to go through, and it's scary. Very scary.
There were a couple of thoughts of doing some kind of writer's guide. I don't think any of them ever came about, and basically because, as Mike says, your guide will be as big as all the source material anyway. It's not that much duplication between.
And another thing, the writers who were doing the research and stuff like that would also pick up a lot of things you can't put in the source book, which is the feel for a character. I mean, I would have loved it if there were a guide to characters that told me, you know, height, weight, hair color, age. Brian Jay write is, I mean, that is a task in and of itself, and you're not going to get that out of some recitation of statistics.
Question for Timothy. I think it's mentioned in Ant of the Empire that Grand Admiral Thrawn knew.
Can you just talk a little slower? I'm getting echoed.
Sorry. My voice is very loud. I think it's mentioned in Ant of the Empire that Grand Admiral Thrawn knew Palpatine before the Clone Wars. Now that the prequels are out, is there any chance of finding out about their relationship plus, that period plus the original Jorah Sumail?
All of the stuff that I've done and all the other authors have done is owned by Lucasfilm. If Lucas wants to do something, pick pieces out of any of the novels, he can do so without any, any problem of consultation or anything like that. My guess is he won't bother. On the other hand, I would certainly find it a real thrill if someplace in movie 2 or 3, this blue-skinned alien just walks across the background.
What I was wondering is if you would actually write maybe an early adventure set in the prequel time featuring those characters.
If I write an adventure, I don't think Del Rey has the license now. I don't think they have any plans to write in that era.
All right.
Up until the demise of West End Games, there was a Star Wars Adventure Journal, and there were places you could put stories like that. In fact, I did 3 or 4 stories of Thrawn's early time before air.
I know.
And I would like to go back, and it'd be interesting to deal with some of the stuff off camera in episodes 1, 2, and 3, just dealing with some of Palpatine's contacts with other people.
Yeah.
But I don't know if Lucas would allow anybody to work in that era at this point anyway. And without short story capabilities, I'm not sure there's a venue for it.
There is supposed to be at least one Del Rey novel which is set between movies 1 and 2. And I think Greg Bear is writing it. But how much control there is over, I mean, I'm sure there's just ironclad control of that era. But it's sort of, you can't go to the party unless you're invited. And they're issuing invitations right at the moment. So.
I would like to do that if I was offered. But so far, nothing has come up that way.
Actually, I've got a question for you. All actors seem to have favourite movies that have inspired them, maybe one way or another, to get into acting. What are some of those movies that have particularly impressed you?
Well, there are quite a few. I'll be here all afternoon if I went through them all. But in terms of the sci-fi genre, I have a particular favourite actually that. Isn't that well known, I think, except maybe to Sci-Fi Plus, and it wasn't, it's a B-movie. It was originally rehearsed by Howard Hawks, but directed by Michael Christian Nyman, or movie. It's called The Thing from Another World. I like that simply because it's shot in black and white. I mean, it must be made in the 1950s or something. It uses very minimal sort of special effects. It's just sort of a tall guy, James Arness, who is bound in a sweater. He's a vegetarian and an extremist vegetarian. He's actually vegetable matter, and his spaceship crash lands in the Arctic Circle, and his scientists recover it, and he regenerates. And they have their effective survival. John Carpenter did a remake of it called The Thing with Kurt Russell some years later. But this one, what I liked about it was the plausibility of the story, but it was the situation, but the combination of that and character. You know, these guys, the reason I mentioned Howard Hawks was because he got the actors to act in an ensemble way. You know, they had very rapid-fire dialogue. They were given a lot of information, but it was all in character. They each had their distinctive ways of speaking. There were no fancy tricks with the camera, no fancy special effects. Often, the camera would be quite still, and the scene involved a lot of people, and the audience speaking very fast, picking up the cues very, very quickly. It was the ensemble acting that course, and I have to say, I enjoyed the original Star Wars trilogy. I'm not used to it because it was a perfect opportunity to revert to being a 12-year-old and not just sit in the cinema with a big ton of popcorn and sit back and kind of watch and eat. Those stories too, I think what's satisfying about them is there is a sense of hope in them. The reasons I don't enjoy so much things like Blade Runner, the effects of Blade, but there is an idea that the future looks a bit bleak. It's a dysfunctional future. And frankly, I'm a little happier with things like Star Wars, which do suggest that there are still grounds for optimism. I think I'll just pause there, because I could go on and talk about the movies in non-science fiction, but I don't want to hog the platform right now.
Just a question to Hugh. Have you been asked by George or anyone else to star in the next Star Wars film, episode 2?
Well, no, not yet. I think he's probably waiting to see if I'm going to become too expensive to employ. It amused me watching part one that when Anakin says to his mom, "Mom, will I see you again?" and she says, "I don't know, what is your heart venue?" And he says, "I don't know, I guess, I hope so." And in my mind, that was George saying, "I don't know what I'm going to do, just kind of back." Maybe she will, maybe she won't. I think he just hedges his bets with everybody. But I would have thought there was a fair chance, but far be it for me to second guess George Lucas. And I think I better keep my mouth shut just in case I say anything that might rule me out of returning to part two.
Any other questions for the guests? Here we go. To you again. Did George give you any backstory on Panaka?
Yeah, this is an interesting point. No, he did not. There was a moment when, in filming of it, there's a guy who works with his films, David West Reynolds. And he and I sat down, and it's his job, part of his job was to develop backstories for individual characters for possible exploitation in other media. And he and I worked out an elaborate and kind of thrilling backstory about the origins of Panaka and why Naboo was non-militaristic and the relationship that Panaka might possibly have had with Queen Amidala's parents. What had happened to them? What's the relationship between Senator Bibble, or Buffalo Bibble, as we call them, and Palpatine, and Chisholm Trust, both of them, and so forth. And, we got carried away, and he put it all, this particular story of George, and went, no. So that was the end of that. In essence, I think, and this is not to diminish what he does, George essentially writes a story, and his main interest is in plot, getting from A to B. He lays down what the characters say, because it's important to advance the story, but we, the actors, have to work out why we say those lines, so we have to bring a dimension of the character to it. And to that extent, he pays us a great compliment. I think he says, "Look, you're the actors, you do the acting." And so he does leave it to us. Except that he only steps in when I think he feels that we're sort of going too far off the tracks. But no, I wasn't given a backstory. I try to evolve one. Not so much a backstory, but just an attitude specifically towards the Jedi, because it seemed to me quite clear that they, as guardians of peace and justice in the galaxy, had obviously not been doing their job since our planet is invaded.
to make Admiral Thrawn an insane clone of Obi-Wan Kenobi, left over from the Clone Wars, is what I heard. But Lucas wouldn't let you, is that true?
It was actually Doris Salioff who was the insane clone, not Grand Admiral Thrawn. Yes, I first suggested you as a clone of Obi-Wan, who, because of what I dubbed clone madness, just wasn't quite right. Thought that would give a lot of great emotional depth to the middle book, when Luke goes to see him and is wondering if this really is Obi-Wan or if it's some kind of a trick or whatever. And Lucasfilm decided that was something they didn't want to do or didn't want to deal with. So I had to invent a clone of somebody else instead. But yes, that was the original plan.
Okay, we've got another couple of questions over here. Stand by.
What's it like working with George Lucas?
Is that just really good?
Yeah, I think all of you can answer in one form or another.
Well, speaking as an actor, pretty much as a sort of hired hand, in the sense that, I don't know, well, how do you strike up a conversation with lots of people? So, George, what do you spend your money on? No, that's not a conversational gathering, but you're going to try out George Lucas. And the kind of things that interested me, when we weren't filming, the kind of things that I thought might be fun to talk to you about, you know, films that you've liked or you might have in common. He's probably had those conversations 100 times already. You know, he's got other things on his mind. And, so, in a sense, I found him, he is a bit of a mystery, and I think it's quite significant that all those guys who were, the people who were working there full-time had ID badges with their photographs. It was a very tight set in the studio, which was just north of London, a place called Leavesden Studios. And you could only access certain areas with an ID badge. And these ID badges had photographs on them. But his was Yoda. Not that he reversed his verbs and saying, you know, go again, we will. he never said that, but he. He's kind of, he's very calm, and that rather impressed me, particularly when in Tunisia, there was, of all places where you'd expect a hurricane, I didn't expect one in the desert, and there was one, and half the set was destroyed overnight, and we went in the next day, and there was just devastation. I should have brought some photographs in to give you an idea of the damage that was done. I was just looking, wow, and I'm being saying this to Jordan, so this is a bit of a setback, isn't it? And he said, nah, these things happen. You know, I mean, he was so calm about it that I think they had something similar happen in a previous film, so the first one, so you know, he took it in stride, but I think it probably also helps knowing that, hey, you're George Lucas and your resources are fairly unlimited, and there was an insurance job anyway.